Praise the Lord. Good evening. I'm your host, CL, and you're viewing the Trinity Channel, broadcasting live worldwide across various mediums to bring you the latest, most pertinent, important information regarding apologetics. And you have been tuning into the Apologetics Marathon, and we're continuing. If you tuned in a little bit earlier, you would have saw a very exciting show on the topic was Muhammad Sinless. That show should be up on YouTube right now. You can go and save it for later. Don't view it now because you've got to stay tuned and view this show because we've got another great topic to stimulate your mind and cause you to critically think and cause you to grow, maybe even come to a Christian worldview. With God, all things are possible in Jesus Christ. I'm your host again, C.L. Edwards. I'm a former Muslim who converted to Christianity, saved by the grace of Jesus Christ. And I know for certain that the gospel of Jesus Christ has power. It has power to affect the lives of all our viewers and everyone in the world. Today's topic that we're going to be discussing is science and faith compatible? We hear so much today. The prevailing attitude of today is, no way. Science and faith are not compatible. In fact, don't we have something called the separation of church and state? In a lot of people's minds, the separation of church and state, which isn't in the Constitution, by the way, that just is a blanket statement that makes faith completely null and void. It has nothing to do with the quote-unquote real world. In the real world, we deal with natural science and the investigation of matter and scientific testing. And we haven't seen any God in any microscopes and any telescopes. So you keep that faith stuff in your church, in your Buddhist temple, inside your mosque. And in the real world, we'll deal with science. But today's show is going to overturn this worldview, this false worldview. And we're going to bring you rational arguments and plain, understandable facts from experts to show you not only is science compatible with faith, but I'll put this forward to you. Faith, science is compatible with the Christian biblical worldview. Now, today's guests that we're going to have live via Skype are Jonathan McLatchie, Dr. Hugh Ross, and Dr. Scott Symington. Let me give you their bios very quickly so we can get into our questions and we can have these gentlemen educate us on this subject. Jonathan McLatchie, who I'm sure if you've been viewing ABN shows, you have seen this gentleman on. Very smart, very intelligent man. Jonathan McLatchie is a Christian writer, international speaker, and debater. He holds a bachelor's degree with honors in forensic biology and a master's degree in evolutionary biology, and his second master's degree in medical and molecular bioscience. Currently, Jonathan is a PhD student in cell biology. Jonathan is a contributor to various apologetics websites, including crossexamine.org, the Christian Apologetics Alliance, answeringmuslims.com. He is also a contributor at Evolution News and Views, the official blog of the Discovery Institute. He is the founder of Apologetics Academy, apologetics-academy.org, a ministry that seeks to equip and train Christians to effectively defend the faith through weekly online seminars and webinars, as well as assist Christians as they wrestle with doubts. Jonathan has also been interviewed on podcasts, radio shows, including Unbelievable, on Premier Christian Radio, Line of Fire Radio, Apologetics 315, Theology Matters with the Pillows, and Solid Reasons Morning Show, and the 1 Minute Apologist, and Dogma and Debates. He has also been a featured guest multiple times on ABN Satellite's Trinity Channel, discussing issues pertinent to science and faith, as well as Islam and Christianity. Jonathan has participated in a total of 15 moderated debates, 8 of which have been formal debates, and 7 of which have been radio debates. Jonathan has spoken internationally in Europe, North America, and South Africa. We also have with us Dr. Hugh Ross. In his short biography, Dr. Hugh Ross, astronomer, best-selling author, Hugh Ross travels the globe speaking on the compatibility of advancing scientific discoveries with the timeless truths of Christianity. His organization, Reasons to Believe, is dedicated to demonstrating via a variety of resources and events that science and biography and biblical faith are allies, not enemies. And last but not least, we have with us Dr. Scott Symington. Scott Symington's background places him in a unique position for impactful apologetic work. Scott was a very popular secondary public school teacher, having been nominated consistently for Teacher of the Year and featured in a university study on motivation in the classroom. The substantial experience as an educator includes development of a district-wide curriculum in diverse subject areas with programs selected for state and national presentations and a master's degree in educational leadership. This was complemented by a master's of science degree in radiological physics, and currently Scott works as a medical physicist specializing in the area of radiation oncology as a board-certified member of the American Board of Radiology. His science and teacher background have flowed into numerous presentations at churches, universities, skeptics challenge groups, and philosophical science and apologetic conferences, making the best in science useful to those of us who may not be experts but want to use all of the best information we have to encourage thoughtful beliefs, which is the name of his soon-to-be website. I welcome you gentlemen to this program, and let's get into the topic, is science compatible with faith? And specifically, is science compatible with the Christian worldview? Now, I'll put this question, first question, to our good friend, Jonathan McLatchie. Jonathan, I ask you, what is intelligent design and is it science?
Well, intelligent design can be defined as the study of patterns in nature which bear the hallmarks of an intelligent cause. And so my first degree, as you mentioned, was in forensic science. And forensic science can be called a discipline of design detection. We want to know, did someone die as a result of natural causes, or were they murdered, or was a fire the result of natural causes, or was it the result of arson? And so there are already principles of detecting design in the world that we already employ routinely. So intelligent design, when we apply it to the biological sciences, seeks to elucidate and determine whether there is real evidence of design or whether we're simply the product of stochastic chance and necessity, unguided processes. Intelligent design is basically based upon the standard principles of scientific reasoning with respect to the past. It's based on what's called the historical abductive method, which is the inference of the best explanation for multiple competing hypotheses, that we try to explain events in the remote past by looking for causes that are now in operation and are known to produce the effect in question. So intelligent design most certainly is a science by virtue of the fact it's predicated upon these standard principles of scientific reasoning with respect to the past. When we look at phenomena which are highly complex, and by complex I mean it's improbable and so improbable that it exhausts the available probabilistic resources and also conform to some independently given pattern, that is to say it's specified, then that type of phenomenon, namely specified complexity, is routinely and habitually associated with conscious activity or rational deliberative agency. As to the question, is it science? Well, a number of objections abound as to why people claim that it's not a real science. One is to say that it's an argument from ignorance or a god of the gaps, but as I just said, intelligent design actually is based upon an inferential argument. It's an argument to the best explanation, and so actually it's not based on what we don't know about cause and effect relationships, but what we do know. So it's a positive argument rather than a negative argument. Another objection is that it violates methodological naturalism, and all good scientific theories are supposed to comply with methodological naturalism, and so it's not science. I would argue, actually, that intelligent design is a perfectly natural phenomena. I mean, it can be supernatural, but intelligence is a type of cause that we have experience of in the world. It's not a material cause, and so it wouldn't comply with methodological materialism, but I would argue that it can be consistent with methodological naturalism. Intelligent design, we're told, is not falsifiable, and so it's not science. But actually, Karl Popper's criterion of demarcation, known as falsifiability, has been largely abandoned by contemporary philosophers of science for many, many reasons. In fact, scientific theories tend not to be falsified by one single anomalous piece of data, but rather by numerous data which accumulate and eventually overhaul a paradigm and accomplish a paradigm shift. Another objection is that it's not science, it doesn't make testable predictions. But in fact, intelligent design does make testable predictions, such as when we look at living systems, which if we theorize that living systems are designed, we should expect to find specified complexity therein, the hallmark of design. So it does make predictions, and so on. So I don't find the objections to intelligent design being considered a science to be very compelling.
Thank you very much for that thorough breakdown of the topic of intelligent design and whether intelligent design is a science. Now, let me pose my second question to Dr. Scott. Dr. Scott, you claim that atheists have a situation similar to ants and a specific caterpillar. What exactly did you mean by that?
I'm sorry, I'm getting the feedback here.
Okay.
Most of us don't pay a lot of attention to ants and their habits, but those that do have noticed that there's a certain type of ant that has this craving for a secretion given off by this certain type of caterpillar that turns into a large blue butterfly. And in fact, they love this secretion so much, they've actually grabbed these caterpillars and brought them back to their ant nest to keep them there. So they have basically a ready machine to get that secretion that they like. But the thing is, the caterpillar gorges itself on ant larvae. So they're doing amazing damage to their future. Now, atheists, here's where the comparison comes in. Atheists have grabbed onto science. They have this craving for science. They feel that they've tied themselves to it, and they feel that it supports their belief system. And they brought that science home. The thing is, though, science has been gorging itself on some of the favored beliefs of atheism. It does a lot of damage to their belief system. Now, the topic of this, does science and faith, are they compatible? That title, it just kind of goes to show that the population has this idea that science and theology, and Christianity in this case, have some conflict relationship. But what we find is there's conflicts with every different belief system, including atheism, agnosticism, but with Christianity, to use another biological term, it's more of a symbiotic relationship where they mutually benefit and support each other.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for that insight about the inner workings in the mind and the worldview of the atheist. Now, just to get Dr. Hugh Ross into the conversation, Dr. Ross, I'd like to pose a question to you. Now, we're discussing whether science and faith can be compatible. So what say you about this topic? And can a scientist be a Christian? Can a Christian be a scientist? Can Christians make substantial contributions to science? Is there a conflict there?
Well, it was that brought me to the faith. I mean, I was raised in a home, but I got interested in science 9 or 7 years ago. And it was just astrophysics that made the guys or had to be a god beyond space and time that created everything. As I looked at the Bible, I realized the Bible taught that God has two books, the book of nature and the book of scripture. And it's through the book of nature that we get the evidence that the book of scripture is totally true. I mean, this is where we discover, for example, that the Bible has predictive power, that it accurately predicts future scientific discoveries. And, you know, I've collected about 200 predictions in the Bible of future scientific discoveries. One is not yet a believer. Put them all to the test and recognize the Bible got a perfect score in everything it predicted about the world of nature. So that's what motivated me to give my life to Jesus Christ and to launch the ministry of Reasons to Believe, of researching the frontiers of scientific research. And this is how I think we can put our Christian faith consistently and progressively to the test. The Bible tells us that the more we learn about the record of nature, the more evidence we'll see for the supernatural handiwork of God. And as our team here at Reasons to Believe surveys the scientific literature, we're discovering an average of about 10 scientific papers a day that add to the weight of evidence of what the Bible says about creation and about humanity and our relationship with God indeed is correct.
Thank you very much. And we just heard from the good doctor. The Bible has predictive power, and it has a perfect score at that predictive power. And we also heard from the doctor just now, he just said to us that 10 scientific papers a day are being published, collaborating the Christian worldview with scientific fact. That's something we need to think about critically. And you need to factor that in when you judge this question. Is science and faith compatible? Now let's go back to Jonathan McLatchie. Jonathan, what is irreducible complexity? And what are some examples of irreducibly complex systems in biology? Could you explain that to us?
Well, Charles Darwin, in his Origin of Species that was published in 1859, wrote, if it could be demonstrated that any complex organ existed which could not possibly have been formed by numerous successive slight modifications, my theory would absolutely break down. And so he put forward a potential falsification of his theory of evolution by natural selection. And in 1996, a biochemist called Dr. Michael Behe, based at Lehigh University in Pennsylvania, put forward this notion of irreducible complexity, where he sought to take up Darwin's challenge and show some systems that did meet this criterion that Charles Darwin described. He defines irreducible complexity as follows. In his book, he writes, by irreducible complex, I mean a single system composed of several well-matched interacting parts that contribute to the basic function, wherein the removal of any one of the parts causes the system to effectively cease functioning. And so the idea is, if you go from if you're constructing a system by Neo-Darwinian mechanism, where you have natural selection acting on random variation that's generated by genetic mutation, then how do you assemble such a system which is not functional until all of the components are present, right? So, for example, he put forward a mouse trap as an illustration of irreducible complexity. And the mouse trap has a number of different components. It has a platform, it has a spring, it has a hammer, it has a hold-down bar, it has a catch, and it has staples. And if you take away one of those components, or two of those components, or three of those components, the trap doesn't work half as well as it used to, or three-quarters as well as it used to, or a quarter as well as it used to, or a third as well as it used to. It's broken. It doesn't work at all. It doesn't perform its function or its job, which is to catch mice. And in fact, the trap might still not work if the holding bar is too short, the spring too lightweight. And so the parts also have to be compatible and matched in very specific ways as well. One example that Dr. Behe put forward in his book, Darwin's Black Box, was the bacterial flagellar motor, which is a propeller which propels many bacteria through medium. And bacterial flagella come in many shapes and sizes. They're very diverse systems. But in essence, these systems comprise of a number of different components, each of which is essential to the system's function or its job. So the bacterial flagella will typically have a have a rotational component that rotates within a stationary component. So as a rotor, which and a stator, it has a propeller, it has a hook or a universal joint, and it has bushings and bearings and so forth, as a rod, which is, and so on. The flagellar components also are built within the cell. So the bacterial flagella are actually quite unlike man-made motors in a number of different ways. One is that they're very, very efficient. They have near 100% energy conversion efficiency, which is well beyond man-made technology. They also can spin at speeds of up to, in the Salmonella typhimurium, which is the paradigm system, they are spinning at speeds of up to about 18,000 rotations per minute. In some species, like Vibrio cholera, for example, they're spinning at speeds of up to 100,000 RPM. Generally, these are driven by ion gradients. So the model system, which is found in Escherichia coli and Salmonella typhimurium, are driven by a proton motive force, whereas in other systems like Vibrio cholera, for instance, it's driven by the flow of sodium ions across the cell membrane. And these actually build themselves. So that's another respect in which they're unlike a typical man-made motor. They actually assemble themselves, and they have very intricate assembly instructions, so they know how to assemble in the correct order. The rod structure, for example, has to penetrate the outer membrane in gram-negative bacteria. Gram-negative bacteria are bacteria which possess two membranes. And the rod structure possesses what's called a rod capping protein, or flag J is the technical term, which possesses two domains. One of the domains possesses hydrolyzing activity, so basically it punctures a hole through the outer membrane. And the other one possesses binding affinity for rod proteins. And besides the four genes that encode the rod subunit proteins, there are more than 10 genes that are necessary for rod assembly. You also have to control the hook length, because the hook acts as a universal joint and is constant across all bacterial species of 55 nanometers in length. And there's two important proteins that are involved. They're called Fly K and Flu B, and basically Fly K is secreted intermittently and acts basically as a molecular ruler that measures hook length, at least according to the conventional model. And the N-terminal domain, the other end of the protein of Fly K, goes through the channel and interacts with another protein called Flag D, while the C-terminal domain, that's the other end, forms a globular structure and stays in the cytoplasm. And then when the N-terminal domain reaches its maximal length, it basically transmits a signal to the C-terminal domain to interact with the secretion gate, which is called Flu B, and that causes or triggers a change in or a switch in substrate specificity. And so basically, and this is closely connected to the temporal regulation of how the different components are assembled in the right order. There's also the assembly of the filament, or the propeller structure of the bacterial flagellum. And the filament has a capping protein called Fly D, which has been described as the most dynamic of all protein structures, and actually is absolutely essential and critical for flagellar assembly. Knockout experiments which knock out Fly D have shown that that it's absolutely critical, because the flagellum monomers are actually lost into the medium. And there's a very tight, regulated expression apparatus, set of mechanisms that control the timely expression of the flagellar proteins to make sure that the components are assembled and built in the appropriate order. So that's one example of an aerobically complex system, and there are many others as well.
Thank you very much for that breakdown on irreducible complexity. And we saw that Jonathan gave the example of a mousetrap. You take away one part of the mousetrap, you don't have a mousetrap anymore, you have a broken mousetrap. So if we can say that about a mousetrap, what about a living cell? What about the optics of the human eye? Something to think about. Now, before we go to break, I'm gonna pose one last question, well, not last question before we go to break, but one question here to Dr. Scott Symington. Dr. Scott, what would be an easy way for us to picture what science and religion actually are?
Well, if you imagine yourself as a night watchman of the house of the universe, of a huge house, and you're required to stay in just the office, and you can't go any, you have to stay in the office. How are you going to monitor or be aware of what's going on in the rest of the house? Well, you use cameras. And these different cameras have their different points of view. And you can label these different cameras in the case of looking at the universe, physics, philosophy, mathematics, theology, history, and so on. Now, each of these cameras sends back information from its unique point of view. And there are going to be some large areas that you can't see with just one camera. There's also going to be some difficult corners in life that you're not going to be able to see with just one camera. So you can turn different cameras from their different viewpoints and look at the same thing. They'll see the same thing, but from their different viewpoints. And that's a pretty good system to know that you have a good awareness of what's going on in the universe. So science and religion, I actually use theology instead of the word religion. What they are, they're not friends, they're not enemies. They're just methods to gain knowledge about reality. And they're coming from their different perspectives. The science uses the scientific method to gain its knowledge, and it has its little circle of knowledge that it can view from that perspective. Theology doesn't use the scientific method. It has its own method and gives its point of view. And sometimes these views, when you put them all together, you have a wider field of view. And where they interact, where they both are looking at the same thing, that's where you can really learn some interesting things as far as which beliefs are accurate.
So these different worldviews are like cameras. They take pictures and they send us back information. And it's upon us to examine that information, look at it, and to make judgments based on this information. Now, the same way that we wouldn't put two cameras at war against each other, no, we would use all of the different methods to gather and pull in information, look at that information, and we would have a true, realistic picture of reality. So if you say, I only want science and I reject theology, then you're rejecting a source of knowledge and information that gives you a true picture of reality.
Yeah.
Deficient.
Yeah, and if you do turn one of those cameras off, it could be from that one darkened area of the house that bad consequences enter and you're unaware of it.
Good point. Thank you very much. And we will be right back. We're going into a break. Don't go anywhere. We will continue this topic. Is science compatible with faith?
Live English debate on Monday, October 17th from 4 p.m. to 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time between Shabir Ali versus Tony Costa. The topic will be, was Muhammad a prophet of God? Was Paul a disciple of Jesus? If you have any questions, please call the numbers at your screen or visit our website at trinitychannel.com. Trinity Channel is now publicly streaming on Roku. There is no need for a code anymore. And through Roku, you can watch us 24/7 on your TV. You can find us through two ways on Roku. The first way is through the streaming channel category. The second way is by searching for Trinity Channel in your search bar. For more information, please call the numbers at your screen. Live debate on September 22nd between Osama Abdullah versus Usama Dakto. The debate will be held at 12 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, and the topic will be, what is Islam's view of non-Muslims and the people of the book? For more information, please call the numbers at your screen or visit our website at www.trinitychannel.com.
Good evening. Back again. This is the Trinity Channel, and I am C.L. Edwards, your host today. And we're examining the question, is science compatible with faith? But more pinpoint, is science compatible with the biblical Christian worldview? We just heard from Dr. Scott Symington, who explained to us that science and religion are like two cameras in a home, watching over the different rooms in the house. They send us back information. And if you turn off one of those cameras, you may be turning off your view of a certain room that you need information about. It could be something in that room that caused you harm. But because you turned off the camera and you turn yourself off from receiving information from it, you become blind. And that's the same thing, we take that analogy. When some of us in our modern age say, we only want science, we don't want faith, we just want science. Keep that faith stuff to yourself inside your church, in your Buddhist temple, in your mosque. You're turning yourself off from a host of information and knowledge about reality. But the person who's open-minded and critical, who can take from all of these different methods, can get a clear, realistic picture of what the universe is really like. We also heard from Dr. Hugh Ross, and he explained to us that there's no incompatibility between science and faith. In fact, the Bible has predictive powers, and these predictive powers have scored a perfect score, 100%. Everything the Bible has predicted and prophesied has come to pass, especially concerning Jesus Christ. And we heard from Jonathan McLatchie, who's explained to us irreducible complexity and intelligent design, how intelligent design is a science. It is a science. And he explained to us about irreducible complexity using the example of the mousetrap. You have a mousetrap, you take a piece away from it, you no longer have a working mousetrap, you have a broken device. That's the same way when it comes to this idea of macroevolution. If you have half of a human eye, you really don't have a human eye. You don't have anything that functions or has any use. So we need to think about these things. We need to think critically. Now, Dr. Hugh Ross, I'd like to get your opinion on something, what Dr. Scott was just expounding upon, about science and religion being two different methods of gathering information. I'd like to get your input on that. How do you see it from your side?
Yeah, I actually see it as the same method. I mean, what impressed me the first time I picked up a Bible is that it followed the scientific method. It's the only holy book I picked up that commands objective testing and shows you step by step how to put everything to the test. And looking at the history, I recognize that the origin of the scientific method are the pages of scripture. And so we're to use the same testing methodology for biblical theology as we are scientific research. And particularly when you look at the creation texts in the Bible, the scientific method jumps off the page. And it's no accident that the scientific revolution exploded out of Reformation Europe. When people began to read the Bible for themselves, they saw this testing method, they applied it to their scientific studies, and that was the birth of the scientific revolution. I mean, for example, you can pick up the very first page of the Bible, Genesis 1. Step one of the scientific method is do not interpret until you establish the point of view or the frame of reference. And notice, before we get into the six creation days, Genesis 1:2 tells you that the Spirit of God is hovering over the surface of the waters of planet Earth. In other words, the point of view for the 6 days is the observer on the surface of the ocean of Earth, you know, on the surface of Earth's waters. And from that point of view, the content of the six creation days is in perfect accord with the scientific record. But most people who look at Genesis 1 look at it as if God is telling us the story from the perspective of someone above the clouds of the earth, not below the clouds. And from that perspective, Genesis gets an almost totally incorrect score. And so, as Galileo said, the biggest mistake you can make in Bible interpretation is to get the wrong point of view. Step two of that biblical testing method, don't interpret. Establish the initial conditions. And you also see that in Genesis 1:2. The Spirit of God is hovering over the surface of the waters of planet Earth, and it gives you four starting conditions. That the water covers the whole surface of the earth, it's dark on the surface of the waters, and the earth is formless and void, empty of life and unfit for life. And you know, then you go through the other steps of the method, but you see all seven steps of the scientific method there in Genesis 1, and every other major creation text in the Bible.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ross. Origins of the scientific method in the Bible? Did you know that this explosion of scientific information that we are enjoying in this modern age came out of the Reformation in Western Europe? Did you know that? Something to think about. I'll give you something else. In the Gospel of Luke, if you look in the beginning chapter, Luke, a physician himself, he begins the gospel explaining that he had done a thorough investigation. A scientist did a thorough investigation to give a full report on the things regarding Jesus Christ. Something to think about. Now, Jonathan McLatchie, we'll come to you. Now, even though evolution seems very counterintuitive, given that the universe is billions of years old, does this not provide significant time for immensely improbable events to take place?
It's a common temptation that evolutionary biologists often fall prey to, which is that, you know, we are used to thinking about years or lifetimes or generations, but we're not used to thinking about millions or hundreds of millions or even billions of years. And so it's a common temptation to think that given a scale of time of billions of years, the seemingly implausible and counterintuitive becomes possible, plausible, and reasonable. Whereas in actual fact, if you run the math and you look at the experimental research that's published in the mainstream peer-reviewed literature, it turns out that even a time scale of billions of years is not nearly enough time to accomplish what needs to be accomplished to explain the radical innovations in form that have happened and taken place throughout the history of life on Earth. We talked just a moment ago about the concept of irreducible complexity, which is the idea that you need multiple components to be present together for a system to operate. And intelligence is the only type of cause that's known that can visualize complexity and bring everything together that is necessary to actualize a complex endpoint. Now, why is irreducible complexity such a problem for the neo-Darwinian evolutionary story? Well, there's a concept in population genetics known as the waiting time problem. And what do I mean by the waiting time problem? Well, the waiting time is the amount of time that you need to wait for a mutation to occur in a population. And the equations of population genetics are based upon estimates for the rate of genetic mutation, the population sizes, and the generation turnover times. We know that throughout the history of life, many innovations have occurred that require coordinated mutations to arise in the population. And what do I mean by coordinated mutation? A coordinated mutation is when you require two or more coincident genetic changes that only together produce an adaptive phenotypic effect that allows for selection to operate. So if you're building an irreducible complex structure or system, you require multiple coordinated mutations to occur in order to facilitate that innovation and form. Now, evolution is supposed to proceed by random mutation acted on by natural selection, sexual selection, and there's also a process called genetic drift, which is a more random process. And selection could only work on mutations with a positive or negative adaptive value. And we know that at least some adaptive advantages require two or more coordinated mutations in order to confer some survival advantage and thus be selected for by natural selection. Now, all mutations have two time constraints that depend on population size and generation time. The first of those, as I mentioned, is the waiting time for a mutation to occur in the population. But there's also the waiting time for the fixation of this mutation, it's not just enough for the mutation to occur and arise in the population. It has to become fixed. In other words, it has to go from being the lone individual out there to becoming the norm that's established in the population. Now, the question that we can ask through the discipline of population genetics, and population genetics is the mathematical expression of neo-Darwinism, the question that we can ask is, does the history of life provide the resources for evolution to accommodate these waiting times? And it turns out very clearly that the answer is a resounding no. With the waiting time dilemma is as follows. When you have large populations, the waiting time for a mutation to occur decreases, but the time it takes to become fixed in the population increases. Whereas with a small population, the waiting time for a mutation to arise increases, but the fixation time, the time it takes becoming fixed in the population, decreases. And thus there appears to be no easy way for evolution to work around the waiting time problem. Now, a potential counter argument might be that recombination, that's where you have exchange of genetic material during meiosis, during sexual reproduction, allows for neutral mutations, which account for about 75% of all mutations to occur separately in a population and to combine later by sexual recombination. However, there was a paper published in 1998 by Christensen et al., which showed that recombination lowers the waiting time until a new genotypic combination first appears, but the effect only appears to be small compared to that with the mutation rate and population size. And so that really doesn't come to evolution's rescue as many people hope it might. Now, when we look at the fossil record, it provides the data which is available for the available time frame, and the standard formula of population genetics allows us to do the math. The waiting time problem was first discovered by Michael Behe in his book The Edge of Evolution, 2007, and also Behe and Snoke wrote a paper in 2004, where they basically made the argument that the waiting time for two coordinating mutations is prohibitive for the neo-Darwinian mechanism of evolution to work. And Behe used the example of malaria resistance against the chloroquine drug, which require two mutually dependent mutations, and applying these data on human evolution predicted a waiting time of 10 to the 15 years, which is way beyond. I mean, the human chimp divergence supposedly occurred about 6 million years ago. Jurt and Schmidt came along in 2008. They were two mathematicians, and they published a very well-known paper in the Journal of Genetics where they sought to actually refute Behe's work in The Edge of Evolution. And what they found was that, in fact, for a two-step coordinated mutation to occur in a hominid lineage, assuming an effective or breeding population size of 20,000 individuals per generation, it would require at least 216 million years for that two-step coordinated mutation to occur. But you only have 6 million years since the human-chimp divergence, and so that's a considerable problem. Sanford et al., John Sanford and others in 2015, published a paper in another mainstream journal, Sanford basically used a computer simulation to calculate calculate waiting times based on reasonable estimates for an ancestral hominid population of 10,000 individuals and a generation turnover time of 20 years, and they calculated the fixation time, the time it takes to become fixed in the population, of a specific point mutation is between 1.5 and 15.9 million years, and the fixation time for a single codependent mutation is blowing out to 85 million years. And so there's these problems. But it only gets worse, of course, when you consider that often changes in amino acid sequence to give a protein a new function must often be accompanied by corresponding changes in regulatory sequences. To give one very quick example, myoglobin is basically a protein similar to hemoglobin, which is used in muscles to help extract oxygen from the blood for use by the muscle. But myoglobin's function is made possible by its higher binding affinity for oxygen. And it's thought that throughout the history of life, hemoglobin was duplicated, and one of the copies went on and underwent changes and evolved into myoglobin. But myoglobin that's present in red blood cells, which is where the hemoglobin is required, wouldn't provide actually a selective advantage. It would actually be harmful to the organism because it would bind too tightly to the oxygen instead of releasing it to the tissues. And so you have to actually get it produced in the muscles where it's required. And so that's also compounds the difficulty there. So there's when the equations of population genetics coupled with the amount of time available as documented by the fossil record, I think presents a significant challenge to the Neo-Darwinian evolutionary story.
Thank you very much, Jonathan. As you can see, even if there were billions of years in this universe, that wouldn't be enough time to explain the life that we see and the irreducible complexity of life as we see it. Now, our next question, I turn to Dr. Scott Symington. Dr. Scott, what are the possible options for the relationship between science and religion?
Well, the nice thing is it's limited. A lot of people would think that, well, this is a very complex topic. There could be all kinds of possibilities, but it's pretty limited. You look through the philosophical and scientific literature, there's only so many options. So if you picture it, I kind of picture it from a flow chart. And the first place that you go to where you first have a division is between validity. Now, are both of these fields of study valid or not? And I'll give you an example of not. If you study, let's say, mathematics and astrology, now when I say valid, I mean, does the field of study, like science, theology, mathematics, philosophy, and so on, does it add something unique and accurate about the universe? If it does, then there's some validity to it, at least some. Now, there are some fields of study, you could say, like astrology, that don't add anything unique or and accurate. It might add something unique, but not necessarily accurate. And if it doesn't add something accurate, then it's just noise. And noise distracts us from finding what's accurate. And if you want to ask later, I can give you an example. But using where mathematics and astrology intersect, you can show that astrology just isn't a valid field of study. Now, let's just assume for the moment that science and theology both are valid. They can add unique and accurate information about reality. If they're valid, then the next point of division is, do they intersect or not? Stephen Jay Gould from Harvard University, he had a theory called non-overlapping magisteria, NOMA, where science, he said, everything, all facts about reality are in the science circle, and completely separate, you have theology, where you have morality and some other vague spiritual stuff I don't think he really understood that much of. And he said they never overlap. And you can ask any one of us to give examples of how that theory just doesn't work. On the other hand, if they do interact, there's only maybe five different possibilities, and that pretty much exhausts it as far as I'm aware. If science and theology interact, you have kind of a continuum. On one end, I've heard the completely overlapping magisteria. I think it was Dembski gave this at a talk. And when he was done talking, I brought up a question and I said, well, he's saying basically all science, all knowledge is God's knowledge. And he's right. But we're not viewing this from God's point of view. We're viewing it from our point of view, which is an incomplete place of knowledge. So, you know, if I want to find something about electrodynamics, I'm going to look in Maxwell's equations, which are in physics and mathematics. They're not in the Bible. And if I want to find out how to have my crimes against a holy God removed by grace and have the best love relationship I could have, I'm going to look in the theology, specifically Christian theology. I'm not going to look in a science textbook. So completely overlapping magisteria, I don't think that one works either. Some people, you know, Dr. Hugh Ross, he spoke of the predictions given in the Bible, and predictions are great for evidence for what model is the most accurate, best explanation. Now, when Hugh will give some of his examples, or when I'm giving some talks, or when Jonathan's giving his talks, some people might think, wow, this is proof. This proves God. But I don't think so. I don't think proof is one of the models that works either, because science doesn't really believe in proof. It just it believes in what's the best explanation of the evidence and then leave things open. And I don't think God, it's not his plan that we earn our way to salvation by solving an equation or earning it by gaining enough proof. If that were true, heaven would like would the population of heaven would look like the Big Bang Theory, minus Penny. But so he's about grace and just trusting him. So I don't think proof is an option either, which leaves only three other possibilities. The symbiotic overlapping model, which I kind of support. There's something called complex contextualized model. And then finally, there's the conflict model. Now, the conflict model is what maybe still most people think this, which is sad, because the scholarship has dropped the conflict model a long time ago. As far as science and Christianity is concerned, the scholars don't see as conflict in that relationship. Now, the thing is, you got to look at the different theologies separately, because Christianity is in contradiction on core issues with the other belief systems. By the law of contradiction, only one of those belief systems at most can be accurate. Therefore, science will have conflict, and just increasing conflict as studies go on, with all the different belief systems except for the one that fits reality. And it'd be my contention that it's the Christian model has a symbiotic relationship with science. And so what you'll see is you'll see a trending upwards over time in agreement between what you find in science and what you find in Christianity. And it's not just science and Christian theology. You can do this with history, philosophy, and other things. You'll see an upward trend if they are both symbiotic, if they both mutually support each other.
Maybe about 5 minutes and 20 seconds before we take another break. I want to get another question in for Dr. Hugh Ross. Dr. Hugh, we just heard Dr. Scott say that science looks to the best explanation of the evidence. And that's what it looks to. When we look at the evidence for life in the universe, should we turn to evolution or should we look to a creator? What is the best model?
Well, Dr. Scott is right that, you know, we look for the best explanation. Science can develop practical proof. It's not capable of developing absolute proof. And so we look for higher probabilities of the model that we're putting forward. And this is where I think Christianity is a lot going for it. The scientific probability that it is accurate and true increases dramatically with respect to time, literally on a weekly basis. And I think where you would go for your question about life is go back to the origin of life, because we now have a very good date for when life first originated on planet Earth. It's 3.825 billion years ago, plus or minus 0.006 billion years. So that's very accurately pinned down. But from an astrophysics perspective, we recognize that's the earliest possible moment in which the origin of life can take place within the universe. It can't happen any earlier, given all the physics and chemistry that must develop first before you have the origin of life. And that's caused some of my peers in astronomy to say, why does it happen so early and why does it happen so immediately? I mean, the moment that the conditions make possible the origin of life, it happens right away. There's no time delay. Well, the answer is you can't get human beings or the equivalent unless the origin of life happens as early as the laws of physics would permit. And then when you look at the origin of life, you discover that within the universe, everywhere we look in the universe and the Earth outside of biological systems, we can't find ribose. Ribose is the 5-carbon sugar that's critical for building DNA and RNA. We don't see any outside of biological systems or the decay products of biological systems. Likewise, we don't see the basic amino acids. And so the fact that you're missing the fundamental building blocks for the proteins, DNA, and RNA and outside of living system tells us that there cannot be a naturalistic explanation for the origin of life. It must be a supernatural explanation. You've also got what's called the homochirality problem, how you can't assemble the amino acids to make proteins unless all the amino acids are left-handed in their configuration. And outside of biological systems, they occur in what are called racemic mixtures, random 50-50 percentages of left and right-handed configurations. And nowhere in the universe do we see a physical mechanism that can drive a homochirality. So this, again, is a signature of a supernatural, superintelligent creator that was responsible for the origin of life, who had the intent in the origin of life to be able to bring about human beings. I mean, as I look at the universe, the Earth, and all of life that has existed on the Earth, I recognize every bit of it plays some significant role in making possible the redemption of billions of human beings. And I just finished a book, Improbable Planet, where I make that case that the way to understand the realm of science is to recognize everything in science is designed for the purpose of making possible the redemption of billions of human beings.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ross, for that breakdown. Supernatural, super intelligent creator who purposely created life, spoke it into being. When we look at the evidence, you've heard the experts here for this last almost an hour. They've given you, each three of them, given you a case. They presented their evidence. What say you? Where are you at now? If you're a person of faith, has your faith grown stronger? It should grow stronger. If you're not a person of faith, are you open to consider faith? The fact is that science and faith are not in conflict with each other. They are very much compatible with each other. There are two different methodologies for gathering information about reality, but they're not at odds with each other. You don't have to choose one and forego the other. We just saw three experts, three scientists, who all are men of faith, not just men of faith, but men who ascribe to a biblical Christian worldview and name Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. Now, we're going again to a break. The show is not over. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back. This is CL, and you're viewing the Trinity Channel.
Live debate on September 22nd between Osama Abdullah versus Usama Dakto. The debate will be held at 12 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, and the topic will be, what is Islam's view of non-Muslims and the people of the book? For more information, please call the numbers at your screen or visit our website at www.trinitychannel.com.
ABN and the Trinity Channel's newsletter are coming to you. In the newsletter, we talk about our future plans to expand, the second International Apologetics Marathon of 2016, and the dire needs of a ministry. We have several projects that need your support to come to life, such as studio equipment, an update to our security, monthly dues, and aiding us in fixing the water damage done to the ministry. If you would like to receive a hard copy of the newsletter, sign up on our mailing list at www.avnsat.com. For more information, call the numbers on your screen.
Watch ABN on your TV. With the Chromecast stick, you can simply connect your phone to the television to watch shows. Download the ABN Sat app and click on the Chromecast button. Need help installing? Contact us at 248-416-1300.
What you're watching here is very unique. Almost all of the media is saturated with apologies for Islam and a blindness to see the truth of Islam and to hear the truth of Islam. This station is rare. It is precious. It is one of the few places where the truth of Islam can be spoken without fear. And we must see this. In my opinion, when you study the history of the early church, it was not only a religion, but it was a shaper of civilization. And today, in my opinion, the church has become too small and is not engaging in what is really civilizational or cultural war, because we are under attack. The invasion of Islam does not mean a funny kind of church where people...
Welcome back. We got an excellent show tonight. We're examining the question, is science compatible with faith? I'm your host today, C.L. Edwards, and you're watching the Trinity Channel. We have three excellent guests, men of science, but also men of faith. And they have been explaining to us how science and faith can be have a symbiotic relationship with each other. They don't have to be in conflict with each other. Now, let's go on to our next question. And this question is for Jonathan McLatchie. Jonathan, what is the Cambrian explosion and how does it provide evidence for divine design from a creator?
Well, the Cambrian explosion is the event which occurred in the history of approximately 530 million years ago. It documents in the fossil record the abrupt emergence of many of the major animal phyla, or the body plans, if you will, of organisms, which appear very explosively and very abruptly with no obvious or clear predecessors or precursors in the Precambrian fossil record. So some of the animals that appear in the Cambrian period include trilobites, for example, or Nomolachiris, or Hallucigenia, or Opabinia, or Waxia, and so forth. And the phyla that are represented include the arthropods and the echinoderms and even the chordates and so on. And the phyla represent the highest taxon, or one of the highest taxonomic categories. The phyla are the major differences between the organisms, or what you might call morphological disparity. So that's what I mean when I say it's the highest of the taxonomic categories. And what you would expect in a Neo-Darwinian picture is for the large-scale differences, or the morphological disparity, if you will, to arise in the fossil record only after numerous small-scale speciation events, where you have the smaller differences adding up to large differences. Whereas in the fossil record, what we really see is the reverse of that, where we see the large-scale differences appear at the start in the Cambrian period, and then you see variations on those themes, if you will, over time. Now, there are certainly fossils in the Precambrian fossil record, but what's interesting is that they are not predecessors or transitional forms leading up to the Cambrian organisms. In fact, what we see in the Precambrian fossil record are often soft-bodied and small creatures, such as fossils of embryos, which are small and soft-bodied, and which undercuts one of the main arguments against the Cambrian explosion as being an argument for design, is that, well, we find the animals before the Cambrian were just simply too small or too soft-bodied to be preserved. But no, we find sponge embryos in the Precambrian fossil record, and so that's a significant challenge to that particular response. But the fact that you find so many animal body plans appearing so explosively and abruptly and immediately in the Cambrian fossil record requires you to posit something to explain the origin of the various animal body plans.
Thank you very much. Abrupt life appearing on the Earth, the Cambrian explosion. When you look at the evidence, should we believe this came about through natural selection, a process of evolution, or was there an intelligent designer who caused life to explode and appear on the Earth? Now, my next question is for Dr. Scott Symington. Dr. Scott, now we've been discussing, is science and faith compatible? Now, what about certain conflicts like between evolution and miracles? How do you explain that?
All right. Well, the first thing is, once you find a belief system that is actually having some support with science and philosophy and history and so on, once you find one that its model is actually showing you some validity, then it's worth looking into some of the possible potential conflicts it has, for example, evolution or miracles. And what you're looking at there is, even if your belief system is accurate, you're still going to have some conflicts because people are involved. And when you got people involved, you're going to have emotions, volitions, or their wants, and incomplete knowledge. There's a number of factors that are involved, so you're still going to have conflicts. So what you got to decide then is, are these conflicts real or just apparent? For example, the miracle, it'd take a while to go kind of deep into that one. I'll cover evolution, just do kind of a quick one. At University of Michigan on Darwin's Day, they invited me in to come talk. And the title of my talk was Much Ado About Nothing, because the main point of that was, there's nothing in any evolutionary theory that says intelligence, guidance, or actions are not involved. There's no way science can ever include that. And how could it? What science does is it studies, the way science describes things is it takes initial conditions and then the natural laws, and then it uses that to kind of describe how things happen naturally. Now, if you have something that operates outside of that circle of initial conditions and natural laws, if there is something outside of nature acting, science doesn't have anything to say about that. At least it can't preclude it. So even if we watched in a microscope things, we watched the origin of life happen and we watched things evolving, even if we saw these things happening, science is still incapable of saying that there isn't something outside of nature that is also involved or not. Now, what science can do is, science can give us some very good information. And you've heard some from Jonathan, and there's a lot of other things I've read through Hugh's work, where science can give us very good information pointing to properties that are outside of the natural. For example, we already have scientific proof that we have the cause of the universe was outside of or beyond nature or supernatural. So evolution, it isn't an actual conflict. It's apparent. I think it's just the way people view, they just don't have the concept of how much science can actually describe, and that it's incapable of describing something acting beyond natural limits.
Thank you very much. Are conflicts real or just apparent? Scientific proof that the cause of the universe is outside of nature. In other words, supernatural. So let me pose this next question to Dr. Hugh Ross. Just hearing Dr. Scott, let me ask you, many people, they go on and on about all the conflicts between science and faith and how these conflicts obviously prove that science and faith can't be compatible. Are there really real valid conflicts between science and faith, or are they just mistakes, human mistakes, in how we look at the evidence and how we view the reality in the universe?
Well, there are many science-based models, and so yes, some of them will be in conflict with the scientific record, and these are the ones that get all the popular attention. So I would argue that young Earth creationism and theistic evolution have significant conflict with the scientific record. But that doesn't mean that there aren't science faith models that are in agreement with the scientific record. And you just heard Dr. Scott talk about how, you know, we can prove that there's a miracle that brought about the beginning of the universe. It's referred to as the space-time theorems. And the power of these theorems is that they're based on only two fundamental assumptions. We know the theorem is correct if the universe contains mass, and all of us are living proof that the universe contains mass. The second assumption is that the equations of general relativity reliably describe the movement of massive bodies in the universe. And we now have observations that demonstrate that general relativity is the best proven and most exhaustively tested principle in all of physics. It actually is able to describe the movements of these bodies to 15 places of the decimal. There's no rational basis for doubting the reliability of general relativity or the existence of mass in the universe. And what the theorems conclude is that there must be a causal agent beyond space and time that created everything. So can science prove that miracles happen? Yes, it can. I mean, I would argue this is the most dramatic miracle that any scientist could possibly hope to uncover, the coming into existence of all matter, energy, space, and time. And if a miracle of that magnitude can be scientifically proven, then I think we as scientists have to be open to the possibility that that causal agent has chosen to intervene beyond merely bringing the universe into existence. And whether you look at the origin of life, the origin of the soulish animals, namely birds and mammals, the origin of humanity, the design of the universe, the Earth, and everything on the crust of the Earth to make possible existence of human beings, you see evidence, not just for hundreds, but literally millions of divine, miraculous interventions that make possible the existence of us human beings so we can develop the technology where we can comprehend the plan that God has for our future in a brand new creation. And to me, that's another powerful argument. We look at the physics of the universe, we see that it's optimally designed to be tools in the hand of the Creator to eliminate and eradicate evil and suffering once and for all. And what you see in the Bible is that the moment that evil and suffering are eradicated once and for all, the universe will fulfill its purpose and God will bring us into a brand new creation, a brand new creation with radically different laws of physics. So just recognizing, if you want to eliminate evil and suffering quickly and efficiently, you need gravity, you need thermodynamics, you need electromagnetism, you need the space-time dimensions to be factored exactly the way they are, you need the universe to be the mass that it is, the size that it is, and the spacing of the stars to be exactly the way it is to make all that possible.
Thank you very much. The space-time theorem. Could it be possible that there has to be an agent outside of space and time that caused the universe to come into being? Those are all a part of the questions that make up the question that we're asking tonight. Is science compatible with faith? Now, we turn our next question over to Jonathan McLatchie, who's been an excellent help for us tonight. Jonathan, what are some of the problems inherent in explaining the evolutionary origins of new body plans?
Well, one obvious problem is traversing the distance between a fertilized egg, that is the zygote, to the viable form of the embryo. Dr. Paul Nelson, who is a philosopher of biology, coined the term ontogenetic depth, which basically describes the distance for any animal between a single-celled state and the adult capable of reproduction. Traversing, you know, a third of the way across the distance from the zygote to the viable form is not going to be a viable organism, or traversing halfway across isn't going to do the job, or traversing three quarters of the way across. No, you've got to traverse all the way across. And so how do you put together a developmental pathway from a zygote or a fertilized egg to a viable form via neo-Darwinian stepwise type of pathway? It seems to strain credulity. Another problem with accounting for the origins of animal body plans, aside from the fact that you need foresight to put together a developmental pathway that has an end goal in mind, is the fact that much of the information necessary for driving the morphogenesis of organismal form actually seems to exist outside the purview of the DNA molecule. One source of epigenetic information that affects embryological development is found, for example, in the arrangement of sugar molecules on the exterior surface of the cell's plasma membrane. Sugars can attach to the membrane's lipid molecules to form glycolipids, and the cell surface patterns that emerge as a result can be extremely complex and hence have a high level of information storage capacity. And in fact, the ability of these structures to influence the arrangement of cell types during embryogenesis has led to it being referred to as the sugar coat. And another contributor to morphogenesis is the distribution and spatial arrangement of ion channels in the cell's membrane. Although these ion channels are themselves encoded by DNA, their spatial distribution is not. And so these ion channels actually establish an electromagnetic field which can influence the form of developing organism. And so if much of the information actually exists beyond the purview of the DNA molecule that's necessary and essential for driving the morphogenesis of organismal form, then you can mutate DNA till the cows come home. You can mutate it indefinitely without respect to the number of trials, probabilistic limits, and so on. And you'll never be able to generate a new type of organism or a new form of organism because DNA is simply the wrong tool to get the job done.
Thank you very much. So the question is to the viewer, did life come about through blind, random mutations, or did there have to be foresight, a goal in mind? And if there's foresight and goal, there has to be an intelligence that does the foresight and makes the goal. Wouldn't you agree? Now, our time is winding down, and let me pose this next question to Dr. Scott. Dr. Scott, what is the latest theory on the relationship between science and religion? And what is the next step, a dynamic way to make it clear what belief system is accurate?
All right. I should have actually mentioned this earlier. Dr. Scott, I must make the sound of it, because I didn't mention this earlier, but I've actually have a couple master's degree, but I did want to stop things earlier because it's the flow that's going through this talk. So, but going into the question, the latest one that I ran into, that it was called complex contextualized. This was the latest thing that was a big significant change in scholarship. So John Headley Brook and a bunch of other names kind of go with this, like Dixon Cantor and Pumphrey and others. What they were saying is because of people being involved with incomplete knowledge and the emotions and everything else and culture, you're going to have some conflict and some support, even if a belief system is accurate, just because people are involved. Now, the thing, I like that, and I think that's totally true. The thing that I didn't like is that explains why we have some up and downs, where we have some things that seem like conflict, even with Christianity and science, and then some things that seem like it supports. But what I think needs to be done is look at the big picture. Look over time, and you can see a trend. Trends are very important in when you're trying to find out what's reality. You see it in your health. You see it in your finances. Trends tell you a lot. Trends kind of step over opinions and hopes and different claims and just kind of show you the reality of the situation. So the symbiotic model that I mentioned before, and this isn't new. I mean, I got the name symbiotic from, I think, Dr. Clayton. He's a geologist probably about 15 years ago. And what I thought was new was this idea of looking at the big trends and seeing how does different theologies trend upwards with time. Like Dr. Ross was saying, you know, they're having new articles every week. And you can just see this trend. And you can also see it with history and philosophy and so on. So I thought even that was a new idea. But I was talking with Dr. Ross at a conference, and he said, oh, no, we've been talking about this. There was even some conference on this very idea of when you just look over time, see how a theology trends. And what I mean by dynamic is here's a dynamic way where you can see what belief system's accurate. You just sit back and watch what science and history and philosophy and archaeology and different theologies will bring. And what you're going to find is all the different belief systems, including atheism, agnosticism, Christianity, Islam, Buddhism, and so on, you're going to see them either trending upwards or downwards in their support with these different fields of study. And you can let these different discoveries do the work for you. They will point you in the direction of what belief system is the one that's safe to base your life and a possible eternity on.
Thank you very much. Looking at the trends of history to see which ideology is safe to base your life and your eternity on. Now, we have a few last minutes, and I'd like to maybe get some wrap-up from all three of our guests, I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Hugh Ross. We've been asking tonight, is science and faith compatible? We've heard a lot of different evidence, a lot of different arguments. What would you like to leave the people with tonight?
Not just that science shows that there must be a God to explain all of physical reality. It must be the God of the Bible. I mean, one of the things we're working on is to believe is making the point that science only makes sense if God is a Trinity. It needs to be three persons and one essence. It explains why science, for example, reveals complete harmony and compatibility, as if there's only one creation plan, and that's the heart of the doctrine of the Trinity, that the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are not in conflict with one another. On the other hand, we notice, when we look at the higher life forms, birds, mammals, and human beings, they have this capacity for expressing and receiving love from one another. They're capable of sacrificing. I mean, we see altruism, where there's a zero possibility of return benefit. These are the characteristics of a triune being. And so one of the weaknesses of Islam, for example, or Judaism, is it can't explain the origin of love or altruism. A triune God is able to do that. And as I mentioned earlier, we're also seeing the scientific evidence is that science only makes sense if this triune God has a redemptive plan for the highest form of his creation, this physical universe, namely us human beings. And what amazes me is that God has worked out this redemptive plan through the way he has structured the natural realm, that we can receive this gift of redemption in thousands of years, not millions or billions of years. And we can look forward quickly to a brand new creation. And I think the two creation model, the fact that God creates this universe to eliminate evil and suffering, and there's a new creation that follows that, again, it's the best way to understand why science looks the way it does, why the universe looks the way it does, why the Earth looks the way it does, why the history of life on planet Earth looks the way it does.
Thank you very much. Like I said, we only have a few minutes. Jonathan McLatchie, what last word would you like to leave our audience regarding this subject?
Well, it's been great to participate in this show this evening. The remarkable thing to me is really the convergence of the physical sciences and the life sciences in coming to a common conclusion, namely that there is design in nature. When we look at the physical sciences, which is Dr. Ross's field, we see immense fine-tuning in the laws and constants of physics and the initial conditions of the universe, and we see also that the universe had a beginning at some point in the finite past. When we look at the life sciences, we find information, we find irreducibly complex systems, we find nanotechnology at a level that just baffles the mind and really it strains credulity to think that it could be the product of an unguided, unintelligent process. And so the more that we look at life and the more we look at the physical realm, the cosmos, the more we see that our presence here, our existence was intended. It was designed for a purpose.
Thank you. We have a little less than two minutes, and I'll turn it over to Scott Symington. What would be your last word to the audience regarding this subject of science and faith?
Well, if you're not a believer in the Christian theology, then I would, no matter what you believe, like in every important decision in your life, take in all the information you can and see where it points and be honest with it, because a lot of consequences are riding on your worldview belief. If you are a believer in Christian theology, and you might say, oh, science isn't really my thing. The thing is, God's going to put different people in your life and that he wants you to have an impact on. And our culture really is into science. So if you don't really know, if you're not going to remember 99% of the stuff we said today. But if someone hits you with a question, you can go to thoughtfulbeliefs.org. That'll be my website. RTB.org. That's Hugh Ross's website. And Jonathan's, I can't remember his specific address. But you can go. There's information that's there. And we can make it user-friendly so you can fulfill that opportunity that God has for you, because our culture desperately needs it.
Yes, thank you very much. And I believe that's apologetics-academic, academics.org first, Jonathan McLatchie. Thank you, gentlemen, for being here. Thank you for all your insights that you provided for us to help us think through this very hard question, but it shouldn't be that hard. When you look at the world, you look at creation, you look at history, you look at the fine-tuning of the universe, you look at the explosion of life, you have to see design. And if you see design, that only tells you that there has to be an intelligent designer. So we've come to the end of this part of our show. Thank you for being a viewer. Thank you for tuning in. Thank you for supporting the Trinity Channel. This is CEO, and I hope to see you on the other side of this break. We're going to continue. We're going to ask some more questions in our next show with new guests. Don't go away.